All right, this is the project we're doing on this video. It is a box that I have aged. We've used some media paints. We've used some chalky paints. It's just a pencil box that I will probably use to hold painting supplies when I go to class. So, irises, first time painting irises for me. I think they turned out beautiful. So let's get started on this project. Okay, I'm going to get started on this project here, and I think it's going to be a really fun project. Now, this box I just bought at Hobby Lobby. The lid slides completely out of it, and you could use it for carrying your brushes to your class, but if you've got long brushes like this one, they won't fit in there. So what I would use it for is I take all this other stuff with me to class, like this is a fold-out ruler. I just bought it at Hobby Lobby. Got my bottle opener, my sponge, sanding pad, my pencil, my eraser, my marker, my stylus, palette knife, compass. So I will keep all of that stuff in here. And then I've got it all in a compact little place. I'm going to slide the lid back on here. Ready to go with me to take with me to class. And then when I need it, I can just pull it out, slide it open, get what I need out of there, and slide it back closed. And nothing's in the way, taking up room where I would need my brushes. And I can always keep this to the side somewhere where I can just pick it up and grab out what I need. So this is our surface that we're going to be painting on. So get all of my stuff out of here. I mean, I could put my graphite paper, which I carry pieces of graphite paper with me, so I can stick that in there as well. Q-tips, whatever it is that I think that I might need in a class, I can stick in this box. So the first thing that we want to do, because this is very raw, rough wood, I want to take my sanding pad and just lightly sand this wood. And this will take that grain down just a little bit. Because this wood, it has always got a very raised surface. And it will probably have a sticker on the back with the price and all that information, so just peel it off, and if it leaves any kind of residue on it, you can use an adhesive remover, or you could try some hand sanitizer to remove it. We want to sand down in here as well. We're going to be painting down in here. Just try to get your surface as smooth as you can. I mean, you can tell when you roll your hand across it how rough it is. So that's nice and smooth, and that's really rough at this end. So, and after we apply our sealer, which we could put it in the base coat as well, and that would save us a step, but because this is such a raw wood, I want to put two coats of sealer on it to make sure that we get good coverage over the whole thing. And you can just take your paper towel and wipe off any dust that's on there from sanding. I do want to get these edges a little bit. So you just want to get all of your sanding dust out of the way. Man, you can just tell a big difference just from that quick little light sanding on there. Just a huge, huge difference. Alright, so our first step is our DecoArt multi-purpose sealer. And I'm just going to put some out here on a foam plate. And I've got a damp 1-inch brush. This is a Lowell Cornell brush. I do sell Lowell Cornell brushes on my website, so if there's any that you need. I may have the size that you need. So we're going to fill in, or brush it on, if I can talk right this morning, our multi-purpose sealer. We want to get it over every bit of this wood. And this is the reason that we're going to do two coats, is because with the first coat, there may be places that you miss. And you just want to make sure that you get it covered really, really good. So after we get this coat on and get it dry, we're going to lightly sand it again. And then we're going to apply a second coat on here. And then we're going to lightly sand that second coat. And then when we come back to put on our base coat, we should have a pretty smooth surface on here. All right, don't let it build up and run anywhere. You know, you want to make sure you keep that pretty smooth. And when we do the lid as well, it's still a little rough there. I didn't get that one sanded very good. You can tell. You can tell. Coat of multi-purpose sealer. When you're working with raw wood like this, it is really, really important to seal the wood. The sealer keeps the moisture from the paint going into the wood and causing the grain to raise. It also will help the paint adhere to the surface. So it's just a good preparation for any kind of surface that you do. I have even used multi-purpose sealer on glass. And it has worked wonderful. I have not had any problems with it, using it that way. So it's an important product to have in your brush, your paint stash that you have, multi-purpose sealer. Should never leave home without it. Okay, I'm going to let this side get dry before I paint the other side. And get this completely dry and lightly sand it, apply a second coat and lightly sand it again. Alright, I've got both coats of my multi-purpose sealer on here, and as you can see, it gave the wood a little bit of a shine. Now, it's very important that you don't let the multi-purpose sealer or your paint build up too much on these edges here, or it will not slide. So if that happens, just take your really fine sanding pad or a brown paper bag and sand the groove on the lid. And if you can get it inside here, sand inside of here, where sealer or paint, varnish, whatever, will build up in there. You could just not paint those if you prefer, but you just want to make sure this is still going to be able to slide real easy after you get it all painted. Okay, so our next step, we're going to paint the inside of the box. It's going to be a different color than the outside of the box. So this is the lid, so we're going to paint the inside of the lid and the inside of the box. So I'm going to mix equal parts, or pretty close to equal parts, of gloss varnish. You can use matte varnish, you can use satin varnish, whatever you want. I want mine a little shinier inside here. And dark chocolate is what color I want to paint the inside with. So I just got them on my paper plate here. This bottle is almost completely empty. Get out as much paint as I can out of here. And then I'm going to take my big palette knife, and I'm going to mix this all together. And we will apply 2 coats of this on the inside of the box and the inside of the lid. And then, after you apply this, your inside will be painted and varnished all at the same time. So we're just going to apply a nice... I would rather that you applied thin coats in here, even if you have to come back and do a third. But I would not do a third up in the groove. If you choose to paint inside the groove, I would not put very much paint in there. You could probably put just 1 coat to kind of, you know, get it to match the rest, but I wouldn't put any more than that in there. So, just a nice large flat brush. This is a 1-inch. This is the same one we used to put the sealer on the outside. So your first coat will be streaky like that because of the varnish that's in it. So I want to come inside here and paint. I've got way too much paint on my brush because I do not want that paint to build up inside that groove. So I'm going to paint up to it. And we're only painting the lower half of the inside in here. This part here we will see when the lid is on, so it will be painted the outside color. I'm going to try and just get a little bit down in that groove, which I don't think is going to work at the best. Just on that edge. Okay, do all edges. Don't want paint to build up down in there, so go up to the edge. Even if you want to go like this and do it, come up to the edge that way. Oops. I think I got a little bit too much in there, so I'll probably need to be sanding that when I'm done, when this dries. Okay, and we'll go ahead and paint the top edge here because I don't want it to come around the outside though. Because this will be covered up by the lid, so it will be part of the inside, if that makes any sense. Okay, one more side here. Get at the color, not a whole lot. Okay, we'll let that dry and lightly sand it and apply a second coat. So this is the inside. The outside has the little notch for your finger to pull it open. So this is the inside. So we're just going to apply a coat on here. Let it dry and lightly sand. Now I could on this piece I could apply it with a sponge or with a foam roller, but I've already got my brush here, so I'll just continue to use it instead of getting another tool out, although it would make it a little bit easier and quicker. Smooth out my brush strokes best I can here. Got some kind of hard line there. I don't think it's going to go away. So, alright. That's our first coat inside the pieces. So we're going to get that dry and apply a second coat and sand in between. We will sand after the first coat dries, and we will sand after the second coat dries. And after you get your second coat, if you still don't feel like it's got good coverage, because the varnish in there will make the paint a little bit thinner. So if after 2 coats you don't feel like you've got enough color on there, apply a third coat, but do not apply it in the grooves. Just apply it on the main sides. All right, the inside of the box and the inside of the lid are all painted. They are sealed because we mixed the sealer in with the paint. I probably could have got a little bit better coverage here down in these corners, but for me it's okay because I'm just going to be putting, you know, things like my palette knife and stuff like that in there. But if it's not as good for you, then make sure you apply a third coat. Actually, I did apply three coats. I just didn't get in the corner with the third one very good. Now, the one thing that you want to make sure after you get done, after it gets completely dry, is if your lid does not slide in here easily, you need to sand it. You need to sand like the edges here where some paint may have built up, and down in the groove where some paint may have gotten built up. And you can do that with a thin, fine sanding pad or with a brown paper sack. Fold up the sack and get it in there and then just rub it back and forth in that groove. But it needs to slide easily back into the box. Okay? So now we're going to paint the outside. And the outside we're going to paint with some chalky finish paint. And the color of this one is Heirloom Heritage. Well, Heirloom would be our color. So I'm going to shake this up a little bit. Open it up. I want to get all that paint that's off of the lid there onto my palette here. So I'm just going to take my paintbrush and scoop that off of the lid. Set this aside because I want to be able to put this back on the paint when I'm done with it. I may take it to the sink and wash all of that off so it doesn't dry on the edge. Okay, so this is a little bit thick off of that lid. So I'm just going to add a little bit of water to it, not a whole lot. And you can apply this with a sponge or you can apply it with a paintbrush. I'm just going to use this brush for the first coat since I had the paint in my brush already. And for the next coat, I will probably go to a sponge because it will apply much faster. Remember, you don't want buildup anywhere on this lid on the edges. But we do need to paint the very edge right here. So, and you can go for a much smaller brush than I just used here. So this is, I'm going to mix some water in my brush here. This is not usually this thick, but I think because it was on the lid, inside on the lid, it's a little bit thicker. I probably should have put it down in the bottle and mixed it in with the other so it wouldn't show so much. This is a little bit darker than I thought it was going to be, so I think I'm going to let this dry on the lid and see if this is the color I'm going to like. I might want to go to a lighter color because I want to do some different techniques and stuff on this, and I want to be able to see it well. So I'm going to let this coat dry, and I might come back and change that color altogether. Okay, so my original color that I picked out was just way too dark for the technique that I want to use on this. So I switched over to a different color of chalk paint, and it is called Everlasting. And I am applying it with a damp sponge. And it will take probably three coats to cover this, this birch wood here. Well, take as many on the lid because I already had one color on here, and so that gave a nice foundation for this one. So I am just going to paint right over it. And this is why I like using a sponge, because it goes on very, very quickly. You can smooth it out very easily with the sponge. And you want to keep your sponge damp but you do not want to have tons of water in your sponge. There are two reasons I like to have a damp sponge or a damp roller when I am using them. The first reason is when I go to, I'm going to use a small brush to get that itch, is when I go to wash it out, I think if my sponge is damp, the paint comes out much easier than in a dry sponge. And also when I am sponging on, it helps the paint go on a little more smoothly. It doesn't drag, because just like with your brush, I feel like you have to condition your sponges and your rollers, wake them up, get them ready to work for you. I think if you use them dry, they're not going to work as well. So those are my reasonings behind dampening my sponges and my foam rollers before I use them. And if it's something that you don't prefer to do, then you know, you're the judge of your painting. So if that way of painting doesn't work for you, then you don't have to do it. That's just what I like to do, and I wanted to pass that information on to you. So now I'm going to get this dry. I'm going to apply two more coats, and then I'm going to lightly sand it. Make sure you get your edges inside here as well, or on the top here. Okay, and inside that little edge right there, you'll probably have to use a small brush to get that. But we're going to apply three coats, because I think it's going to take three to cover this box. And completely dry, sand them, then we're going to be ready to go. Ooh, I'm ready to get started. Okay, I wanted to share something with you as I'm applying my second coat. And I'm just using an artist sponge, by the way. I found that if I pounce it on like this, it gives me a little bit better coverage, it seems like. And if any of you have watched any of my other videos, I like a little bit of texture in what I'm painting. So it just gives a very slight texture to the surface, but a little bit better coverage than just brushing it on. That's just brushed on, and that's sponged on. I think it gives a little bit, or tapped on, I guess I should say. Gives a little bit of, you can see a little bit of texture there. And if I keep tapping gently, it will take that texture down just a little bit. So, but I like to have a little bit of texture on my pieces when I'm painting them. I just think it just gives it a little bit more character, makes it more interesting. Everything doesn't have to be smoothed out and, you know, perfect. I want a little bit of, oh, I don't know, a little bit of character. But if you like it smooth, then go for it, because it is your piece. And oh, I just set that down on that wet side. Don't want to do that. Don't do what I do. Well, do what I do, but don't do what I just did. All right, I'm going to set it on the top of this bottle, so I'm not setting it down on something. So I'll show you on this, because you can see the first coat, how thin it is. So this will be the second coat, and this will probably also help you keep from applying three coats instead of two. So you see how well that covered that? And just that little bit of texture makes me happy, happy, happy. Alright, I'm gonna get this finished, get it dried, get my edges painted there, and get it sanded. Alright, I've got all my coats on. They're all dry, lightly sanded. Now, it's not fitting quite the way that I want it to fit in here, so I have cut a little piece of brown paper bag just where it will fit in this groove. And so I am just sanding this groove to make sure that my lid will slide nicely in here. Sticking mostly at the back here. Okay, so now I'm going to, I sanded the edges of the lid with my sanding pad, so now I'm going to see if it fits in here a little bit better. Still feels like it's sticking a little bit, So I'm thinking that's some buildup on the edge of this, so I'm going to lightly sand it in. I think I'll use the paper on the very edge right here. Now, when you put your varnish on this, you'll have to do the same thing. After you apply your varnish, you'll have to come back with your brown paper bag piece and do along the edges like this so that they don't get buildup. Still feels a little bit stiff in there. Down towards the bottom. Oops. And a little bit up here in the front. So I'm going to sand a little bit more with this sand, with this brown paper bag. When this piece gets wore out, just cut yourself another piece that you can fold up and get down in there. Try and get all that sanding dust out of there. Now, one of the really good things about having your lid and your inside already varnished, we mix the varnish in with the paint, is that if when you're painting the rest of it, and you have paint on your fingers and you pick it up, it's like, oh my gosh, I got paint all over that. Well, don't panic. Just get a damp paper towel and wipe it off, because it's already got its varnish on it. It's already sealed. So you don't have to worry about that. One of the added benefits of adding the, well, it still feels a little stiff down in the bottom, but I think I'm going to leave it for now. We're just going to move on to the next step here. Okay, our next step, I'm going to go ahead and put the lid back on it, is I want to add a little bit of aging to this box. So I'm going to take my dark chocolate, put some of that on my palette. I think I need to clean my palette. And I'm going to take a very damp sponge. I want a little bit of water in this. And then I'm going to take my paint and kind of mix it into that damp sponge. See all that, when I tap, all that water that's still in there? Okay, that's what I want. So I've got a little bit of paint mixed in with water. This side is just damp. Which I think I will get a little bit more water in that edge. So I just stuck it down in my water and then squeeze the excess out. I want that a little damp so I can move my paint. So we just want to start. The wonderful thing about chalk paint is that it is like a flat paint. So it will take other paints on it beautifully. But if you're using a dark color, also like a chalkboard, it will mar if you get something rough against it. So, I just want to start adding some aging in here by just tapping this sponge and taking the side that has no paint and just kind of softening that back. We're going to do this all the way around. Might make it a little bit darker in the corners. And blend it out. You probably don't need to have as much water as what I have here. I'm just tapping it and blending it and softening it all at the same time. I like that a little bit darker on there, on those edges. So I'll go back and redo the other ones. I want to really make the corners look a little more dirty and rustic. You know, like the box has been handled a lot. It's been around forever and ever. Feel like you just need to wipe it off, then go for it. It's pretty wet, so you can do with it whatever you want. If I feel like this edge of the paper towel is getting a lot of paint built up on it, I'm going to take it to my paper towel and lay it down and let that paint that I've been blending come off of my sponge. Do the bottom as well. You don't have to do as much on the bottom. Then we're going to go do the top, because the bottom, you know, you're not going to see it. But you like your piece to be completely finished. So I'm just tapping and smoothing with the damp sponge. It's getting kind of dirty effect to that. Now we want to do the top. The top needs to be done as well. So I'm going to get a little bit more water, a little bit more paint, and we're going to do the same thing. Now I could take it off of here and do it, but get some of that paint on that edge. So now I'm just going to blend it out a little bit. I don't want this color to be so dark on the lid. I just want it to be a little bit more subtle. Get a little bit along that edge. I will take this apart to dry, because I don't want it to any moisture that's coming from the sponge to cause the lid to stick. Okay, now I'm going to go to the back side of the sponge. And I'm just going to start softening this and rubbing it and blending it. I just want it to look a little dirty on the top. Okay. So now I'm going to take my lid out, and I'm going to let them dry separately so that the lid doesn't stick to the box. Okay. Got this dry. I lightly sanded the edges just in case. It slides fine in the box, so that's what you want to do. You want to make sure that it... Oh, I say that. No, it's not wanting to go. There we go. So it's still sticking a little bit on this bottom edge, so I might have to do some fine-tuned sanding there later. Okay, now we want to do some really fun, more fun to it. I just want this to just look old and just different. So I've got this Paris postage stencil, which I got from creativeartslifestyle.com, and I thought that I had the smaller, the 6x6 stencil, but I can't find it, so I'm going to go with the big one here. And we're just going to randomly, very subtly, put some of this on there, and I'm going to use a makeup sponge to do that. So I've got my same brown color, my dark chocolate, and I'm going to tap, put a little bit of that on my sponge and tap it. Now, makeup sponges are not very absorbent. They just kind of let everything hang out on it. So you want to tap that and kind of blend it into the end of the sponge so that you don't have tons and tons of paint on there. And then we're just going to go on here and kind of put some random subtle stencils on here, and you don't have to get the whole stencil. You can just do a little bit, get a little bit of coverage on there. I can't get those letters at all. colors. Like your, we're going to be putting some stuff on this lid, so we don't, you know, have to worry about it covering and being, you know, all filled up with other stuff. But we want some subtleness in there. That's a little bit darker than what I would have wanted, but we'll just go for it. I think I'll put part of this up here in the corner. Just a little bit of subtleness. I don't have hardly any paint on my sponge here, so it's you know, helping me not put the color on quite so dark. And we're going to do this on the sides of the box as well. I have enough paint that time. Try and hold your stencil to keep it from bouncing. Little letters just don't want to go on there. We'll just go with that one. So we can just pick and choose. We can put some of this wording on there if we want. I don't know how well this is going to work with this makeup sponge. It might work a little bit better with a brush because I can't really twirl this on here. So that's not too bad. Put a little bit of this down here. Okay, so that's probably good enough for the lid because we're going to be putting some other stuff on it. Although I feel like, oops, drop a sponge. I feel like the center up here needs something, so I might put guy up here. I can't get him kind of subtle in there. Oh yeah, that looks nice. Okay, so we want to do this to the sides. Now the sides, you're going to be just a little more, you know, just pieces of things. Because unless you've got the smaller stencil where you can do a little bit more. I didn't have near enough paint on my even show that up. So let's see if I can do that again. Okay, much better. So we're just going to do stuff like this randomly along our edges. No rhyme or reason to it, just make it look old. Of these sides here, and you can put some on the back if you want. You know, the bottom's not really as important unless you just want to make it look like a box that was mailed and got stamped everywhere on it. So, you know, it's up to you whether you do the bottom or not. It's not near as important as the sides and the top. Have a little bit more paint on your sponge to do the lettering, I think. But I want it subtle on there. I just want it to look worn down. Okay, so that's our next step. All right, I've got my box completely stenciled, all sides. Just very subtle stenciling, even the back. The back is optional. And I made sure that this is going to slide in easily. Alright, I've covered my surface with some paper because I've decided what I want to paint on here. It's going to be some irises. So I've not painted irises before, so that's going to be a lot of fun for me. So the first thing that I want to do to this background is create some more fun stuff on just the top of it. Now I don't want to do the edges, I just want to do the very tip top of it. So I'm going to take my Scotch tape and I'm going to tape off the very top edge of the box like this. This will keep what I'm going to be doing to the lid next from getting on those edges, because I want to keep those just the way they're painted right there. Okay, our next fun step. I find all of my products here. We're going to apply some media paints to this. And we are going to apply them using these mini misters, which I purchased mine at Hobby Lobby. Use my 40% off coupon. I believe Creative Arts Lifestyle carries some. I don't know if it's this particular Ranger brand, but they do carry some. So I have filled them about two-thirds or three-quarters of the way full with water. So my water goes to about to there. It's kind of hard for me to lay it flat for you to see it and still be able to see the water. Alright, so now I want to create some light colors to spritz on the background. And so I'm going to take one of these and open it. And I'm going to take my green and I'm going to put one little dot of this green. This media paint is so vibrant. It does not take much in there. So I just stuck a little drop in there. And I put it way up here at the top so it's not down all the way in the water. Okay, and then I'm just going to gently let that blend in there. I want it to be a soft color. The purple probably got a little darker than what I wanted. If I'm going to test spray it, and if it's too dark, I will go dump it out and refill it. Okay, and this one, I want to put some brown in it. I was going to put some yellow, but I think I'll do some brown and do some spatting. And this color I could put all over the box if I wanted. Now, I don't know if this is the proper way to use media paints. I love these because they're like true pigments. They are 100% acrylic polymer pigment. So it's a very strong color, and they are wonderful for glazing on things. So now, when you mix these in the bottle, you want to gently mix them, or you want to roll them like this. You don't want to shake them. At least that's the instructions on the bottle. So I'm just going to blend this out a little bit. And I want to show you how I played around with the sprayers here. The first time I mixed the purple, I got it a little dark, but you can see how it just spritzed out in a fun effect. And so I thought, well, I want to see if that will work with the stencil, so I laid a stencil on here. And I loved how it turned out with the stencil. So you could tape off any parts of the stencil that you don't want to see and around it, because the spritzing goes out a little ways, and you could spritz subtle little colors in the background of stencils in your background. So then when I remixed it, I got a much paler. I don't even know if you can see that. You can see it's one of my scrap papers, but it's very, very soft. So I want to take a piece of scrap paper, and I'm going to spritz each one of these colors out to see if they're still like that. Kind of goes everywhere, so. Oh yes, that's a very soft, pale color. I like that. So let's see how our green looks. I haven't used this one yet. And I'm back a little ways from the surface so that I just get a subtle color in there. And then the brown. Oop! I just sprayed that all over my computer screen. I can get some brown in there. Right. I had to get that off my computer screen before it completely dried on there. Okay, and these media paints, they are so much fun to play around with, so I highly recommend getting some. So I want to start with my purple, and I think I'm going to stand up to do this because I want to be back a little ways. I don't shoot fire. Just did it again. Okay, and I just want to spritz this color on there. And then I'm going to put some green on there. I've mixed it with water so it will dry very quickly. And then a little bit of brown on there. Now this brown I could put on the background. I think I want to do a little bit more purple. I want a little bit more purple in there. So, oh, that is so much fun. So much fun. Okay, I'm going to get that dry, and if I feel like it needs a little bit more, I might add another drop of my media paint. My purple. It's dioxinine purple. I might add another drop in here and shake it up and get that purple just a little bit darker. But what I like about mixing it in the bottle with the water is that it makes it disperse a little bit more quickly, and I love that. Instead of glazing it on with a paintbrush, I've already got the water in it, and so it just makes it spread out so beautifully, and I love that. So I don't know if acrylic paint will give you the same effect, but you could probably try it with acrylic paint, although you'll have to make sure you get mixed in good, because I think acrylic paint will clog the sprayer a little bit quicker. So I'm going to get it dry, and I think I will come back and spritz it again. Alright, I've got it dry. Now I'm going to spritz it again. I've added just a little bit more color to it, and I'm going to get a little bit closer this time because I want to concentrate that color in some certain, you know, areas like that. And then with my green, maybe back in there. Now that's a little bit more than I wanted right there. And then my browns. I think I'm going to do my purple again because I want more purple in there. And that right there is too stark of a dot for me. So I'm just going to tap that with a sponge and lift that up. Because there's so much water in it, I could take it right off of there. And if I feel like this is too dark, I can do the same right there and just take it back just a little bit, just to make it a little more subtle. I'm just barely tapping with the sponge. I don't want to remove all of it. I want to remove a little bit of it. Okay, that is just beautiful. Okay, I think I'm happy with how those colors are going to be on there, so I'm just going to remove my tape off of here and get it completely dry. Another way that you can put this media paint on here is to just take a paintbrush and put some dots of it on here, and then take a bottle with just water in it and mist it, and it will disperse in pretty much the same way. But I like having it mixed there, so I feel like I can control it a little bit better. So just get some and have fun with it. It's a fun product. Okay, now your makeup sponge, you want to keep using it until it's completely done, so you can lay it on your palette paper just like this and let the end of it dry. When it's dry, just take some scissors and cut it off, and you're ready to use it again. Alright, I got my pattern transferred on here, and so we are going to start painting in. I think we might paint in the leaves first. Just get them base coated in. We're going to base them in with avocado. Alright, let's start with... Oops. Sorry, I have to switch my glasses here. Hang on. Let's start with painting these in with a flat brush. And we'll probably use a round brush along the way So I would say have a couple sizes of flats and a couple of sizes of rounds handy. I'm going to have a 10 flat and 8 if I have one. Okay, yeah. A 10 and an 8 flat, and I've got a 1 and a 4 round. So that should get us pretty good for painting in these leaves. I don't know that I will use all these brushes, but I'll have them handy just in case. Now, I know that you can't see my lines very well, but I can see them. I didn't want them really dark. Something in my paint there. I didn't want them really dark. To our leaves here, or up to our flower petals. I'm really looking forward to painting these iris. I have never painted them before, but irises, lilacs are my favorite flower because they bring back just wonderful childhood memories. But irises do as well, just not the same type of memories. These grew wild at the edge of our property as a child growing up, and I remember every spring going back and picking some and bringing them in the house. Oh, the smell of irises is just the most wonderful smell. Well, besides lilacs, because lilac is my absolute favorite, but irises have such a wonderful, wonderful scent. They're very sweet and fragrant. So they bring back some wonderful memories. So we're just going to get these all base coated in with 2 coats of our avocado. We'll be adding some little grasses and stuff down in here, so you don't have to worry too much if that's, you know, got kind of jagged ending and stuff. You don't have to make sure that your ending down here is perfect. So I'm just using the 8 round, I mean the 8 flat, goodness gracious. I am just getting over being sick for several days, so I probably sound pretty congested right now, so excuse me if I sniffle. Okay, where's my next one? There's one up here. I'm going to stay with this flat brush here, but I want you to use whatever brush that you feel most comfortable with. Now, the brushes that I list in my packets are the brushes that I use, but they're not necessarily brushes that you have to use. So, I don't have that line in the right place at all. So if, you know, you have other brushes that you like to use, then just feel free to use what you are comfortable with. I do sell, this is a Low Cornell brush, this is mostly what I use. I do sell Low Cornell on my website, so my website is lonnasstrokeofart.com. Now, when you're base coating with your base colors, it is, and I know that I say this on all my videos, but in case you're watching it for the first time, I like to have my paint thin down a little bit with some water, because I think it just gives you a smoother, much smoother painting, and it may mean that you paint in your base coats with more than 2 coats, but that is perfectly good because you don't want ridges, you don't want a lot of hard lines in your base coats, because if your base coat is nice and smooth, then the rest of your painting will look fabulous, because it's all where it starts with the base coats. And I know that the background and all the stuff took a little time on this box, and it is the part, I have to say, that at least for me as a designer, that seems to be the most tedious, because I just want to get it done so that I can get on to doing the part that I think is the fun part, which is painting the design. So just be patient with it, because it will all pay off in the end. Your background and everything really does affect how your painting will look in the end, because if you've brushed it and you've got a lot of bumps and thickness and hard lines and things that just aren't very pleasing to the eye, then your whole piece is going to not look very good. This is the rest of this leaf over here. Might be kind of hard to separate those when we get all the... Oh, got yucky. So, and these stems are kind of fat at the base, so we want to fill all that in there. We'll have some grasses and stuff coming up. Let's see. I think I'll switch over to a round brush. And I'm going to go ahead and paint the stems in with this avocado. We won't go all the way up to the flower yet. And then they kind of are fat at the base here. And then their stem comes down from that. Got our flower going across there, so I don't want to cut through the flower. Again, it's fat there. Need a little water to my paint here. My paint is very thick, I think, because I'm getting to the end of a bottle here. Okay, I've got one more small leaf here. It is attached up here to the upper part of the stem. Okay, so we've got our first base coat on our leaves. So I'm going to let them get completely dry. And all the only brushes that I used was an 8 flat and a 1 round. So that should be all the brushes that you need. So I'm going to get this dry and get the second coat on here. All right, I've got my two base coats on my leaves. So now we're going to base coat in the petals. And we're going to base coat them in with, I'm going to use lilac. So let's see if I can zoom you in so you can see this a little bit tighter. Want you to do this. When you're doing your petals, I want you to kind of wiggle your brush and get a little bit of movement on your edges. Now this will be kind of flat here because we're going to have a curved place up here. And do one petal at a time. Make sure you keep them separated, so you want to push on the outside edge and then bring them together, and then you can just fill it in. That will help us when we start adding more definition with these petals, because I irises are so fluffy. They're so lacy looking at the edges. So we want to try and keep that lacy movement. If we can. So when we come back and define the other parts of it, it'll be much easier if we've created a little bit of movement already painting in our petals to begin with. So I hope that I made that somewhat clear. I just want a little bit of wiggly movement on the outside edge as you paint it. Okay, we've got one up here. I'm gonna be up on the toe so I don't paint on top of that other petal there. And flatten out as I get up here at the top. I'm gonna turn my project as I need to so that I can, for me, it's much easier if I can pull towards me, especially when I'm trying to do some wiggling stuff. Okay, look at my pattern. This is still part of that petal right there. So that back one is a very tall petal. And we've got this one here, and it's got a turn. It's flipped right here. So the back side of it will be fairly smooth. And then this edge will be a little wavy. Now, after you get your coats on here, if you completely cannot find your lines, then you can go back and lightly put on your pattern lines. Okay, so that is the one main flower at the top. And then we've got this flower over here. So I'm going to work on these. I'm using an 8-flat, but you can definitely go to a smaller brush. I'm going to kind of stay up. I want to get where you can see me. I'm going to stay up on the edge of the brush because this is just the tip of one of the petals that is folded up right there. And then it comes down over here. You can just kind of fill it in down here. Okay, and then we've got that's coming over here. Let's see. Actually, that petal is going up here. So we'll just make another petal on there. Keep that wiggly movement. Go around that one so that I can, you know, maintain where that particular petal is, and then I'm just going to fill this in. Okay, now this one has 3 petals that are folded down, and this one is kind of back here. So it's just got a little bit of it that we can see. And then this one is a much bigger petal. Here. right here. If you keep the majority of the paint on the edge of the brush, that's going to be on the outside edge, and just push it, then you can get a nice, good chisel edge there. Okay, so you can see where we've got our petals based in. So I want to let this dry and apply a second coat on here, and then I'm going to put my pattern back on just for you guys to show you where my lines are, to show you where we'll be separating the petals and painting next. Alrighty, let's get started here. I've got all my base coats done. I went in and drew my lines back so you could see, you know, where what lays on top of what and see it a little bit better. So I'm going to zoom you in here. We're going to start painting on the irises, on the flowers themselves. Now, I drew my irises where the petals are all mostly up except for these down here. And you can adjust your petals and make them open if you prefer. So you can draw some center stuff in there. Now, irises are many different colors. And the ones that used to grow behind my house were these vibrant purple, the leaves that were lower were these vibrant purple leaves, and they were just the most beautiful flower ever. So I don't know that I will get close to that vibrant color, but I'm going to do mine in purples. Now there's yellow irises, there's white irises, there's pink irises, there's like a deep maroon colored iris. You can Google iris and find just about any color of iris that you can imagine. So we're going to start with the color lavender, and I want to create a little bit of a center vein down this, but then we're just going to keep the color, just move it out towards the edge there. I always like to use a mop brush and mop. I want to keep these colors nice and soft. Now let me show you, if you're the first time painting with me, when I do my loading for floating, I spritzed water on this side of my palette. So I've got all different size of water drops just with a misting bottle. Okay, so I will pick it up on the curve. I use a curved flat to float. I will pick it up on the curved edge if I need more water. Sometimes my paint feels a little dry, and I will pick it up on the tip where I load the paint. Then I go over here and I tip the toe of the brush into the paint, and then I work it back and forth right here. Now some people like to load theirs like this, but to me that takes a lot of work. So if that's the way you prefer to load, you can go ahead. I like to do it this way. It's you get the same exact effect there, only instead of flipping my brush back and forth like this, I'm just laying it back and forth like this. Okay, it's the exact same loading process, exact same effect on the brush. Just depends on which way that you like to do it the best. I'm going to leave a little bit of lightness in the center there, and just kind of tap and move that color out to the edge a little bit, and then I'm going to mop that. Pick up some more water and paint, load it the same way. You don't want tons and tons of paint on your brush, but want enough. If you've got enough water on there, you'll be able. Now I'm turning my brush to where it's more straight up and down like this instead of laying flat like this, because I'm coming around this curve here, that turned place, and I do want to put some paint around that turned place. And then I'm just going to tap it, and then I'm using the water edge of the brush to just soften that and blend it out a little bit. Now I'm hoping when these are done that they look like irises, because I've never painted one before. And so, I need a lot more water in my brush. I don't know how well you can tell that's dragging right there. Very dry. Brush is very dry. A little bit of a hot day here today. One of our first hot days we've had. That is just way too dark for me, so I'm going to take my finger and just scrub that off of there. Okay, and I just kind of patted it in there. Gently soften that. Okay, I want some of this color to be at the base of these upper petals. Now, well, we won't see a whole lot of this color because most of the petals are behind, but this one on front we will see. So we want to start by, I just went and picked up a little bit more paint because I had a lot of water right there. And so because I had a lot of water right there, I could pick up more paint and move it where I need it. I just want to move it up that flower a little bit. I know that looks just terrible, but I'm going to take my mop brush, and that will soften that and blend it a little bit. A little bit of a hard line on that edge, but we're going to come back and add some more colors in there, some deeper purples. This is lavender. This is just our first color. I think I'll go ahead and put a little bit around here. Not too much. Peeking out from that petal, and then this petal here will have a little bit more we can see, and then maybe I've got a little petal right there. Okay, so we can kind of now see the separation of those petals a little bit more. I'm going to come back and shade on this edge here and this edge, but I want to use my 6 curved flat for that. Right now I'm using my 10. Okay, let's go over to the other flower. I may have to turn my ceiling fan off. My paint is drying very, very quickly here in my brush. So let's start with this one. Now, for those of you watching this video, most of my videos in the past I have filmed shooting over my shoulder. Well, I have knocked my camera over 2 or 3 times, and so I had my husband mount me something above, and I'm not quite used to it yet, so you know, any comments to let me know what you think will be very appreciative. Load more water and paint as you need it. I'm just starting with soft color. No need to get glaring with our colors yet. I love starting with the soft colors. And then you can keep it soft. If you choose to keep it soft, you don't have to, you know, go back and do a whole lot to it, add a few deep colors here and there, but you know, it gives you a little more option as opposed to, you know, just getting it all painted in with dark colors and then wishing you had some softness or some light colors to it. And I always use a mop, always. And let me make a damp place on my paper towel. I'm going to show you how I clean my mop brush. I show this in all my videos. Oops, throw my brushes around here. So I've got my paper towel, and I've got a damp, fairly clean damp place right there. So I've got some paint in my mop brush. So I'm going to take it to, I use my mop brush dry, and I sell these on my website, 2 sizes. This is 1/2 inch, and I sell 1/4 inch. And I will go to that wet spot and clean the paint out, and then go to a dry spot and dry it out. And then I can look and see if I've got all the paint out of it. You want to try and clean it as much as you can, especially when you change colors, because if you go into a very wet place, you're just going to transfer that paint from your mop brush right onto your piece where you may not want it. So it's a good habit to get into cleaning it after every time that you use it. Alright, we're going to put a little bit around this one. My biggest concern is having my camera up above me is that you can't see how I'm laying my brush sometimes as well. So if that is the case, because as sometimes when I'm painting, I'm not always looking at the monitor that I have set up to see what you're seeing. So there may be a time when I think you're able to see what I'm doing, and fact being, you can't see anything. So be sure and let me know. I always look at the videos when I'm done and edit them, but by then it's too late to redo it. I would rather be aware of what I'm doing. Well, you weren't even on camera for that, so there you go. See? I was just shading around this petal right here. Alright. Okay, that's looking good for our first little shading on there. Oh, I'm going to love these irises. I hope you are too. Okay, I want to mix a little bit of that lavender in with our green. I'm just going to dip into my green here, dip into my lavender, and create like a muddy purple color there. And I just want to pull some of this color down into the stem, right here where it attaches. If you've got any graphite lines that you need to erase, now would be a good time to go in and erase, you know, anything that you don't need. My graphite lines are there for your visual aid. Okay, so let's get some dioxazine purple out. And we're going to get this on my palette here. Need a whole lot of paint with this flower. It's just an easy one to. I think before I start adding dioxazine purple, let me find my six curved flat. Now, when you use your brushes, you got to wake them up. So you've got to let the bristles get completely full of water, and then you just take it to your paper towel and. Let me just show you what I'm doing on camera here. Okay, so I've got my brush. It's a new brush. I haven't dampened it yet, so I want to get it damp. So I want it to fill up with water. So I need the bristles to wake up. It won't work for me if they're not awake, if they're not conditioned. So we've got to get it full of water. So now my bristles are full of water. If you've got a basin like this, where you can rest the brush where it won't be against the bottom to bend the bristles, you can put it in there for just a few seconds. You just need it in there long enough to fill the bristles. You can push it against the edge of the basin and let the bristles really get full. Okay, and then after it's full, you just want to lay it on your paper towel this side and lay it on your paper towel this side. Make sure you're ferrule is completely dry. You don't want any water running down. And that's it. Your brush is awake. The bristles are happy. They are ready to paint for you. So if you don't wake your bristles up, and cleaning them after you paint is very, very important. Especially with the expense of brushes, you want to be sure and take good care of them. So they want to work good for you. So we just want to float along this edge, the turned edges. I'm using a six curve flat. It's a Lowell Cornell brush, which I sell on my website. My favorite brushes are these curved flats, especially for shading. I just love how they work with shading. Those were the only three that had some turned edge, although this one up here, I could use my bigger brush for this one. This one up here is actually turned, so we're going to do the outside edge of it as well. That could come out just a little bit farther. So I just tapped in some paint, walked it, which is called walking. So when you do your first float and then you need more paint, you just bring it over to the paint edge. You scoot it over into the water edge that you just left with the water side of your brush. And I just kind of tap it in there and let the water get some of that paint. And then I take my mop brush and just very gently mop that. I know sometimes if you're watching my video, it looks like I'm pouncing like this when I'm mopping. Well, there will be occasions when I'm pouncing like that when I'm trying to get some of the paint off. But most of the time, I'm just barely tapping into that water to soften that float that I just did. All right, now we're moving on to dioxazine purple. And here we go. Now, these petals down here are going to be very dark. Well, darker. So I want to take this dioxazine purple, I want it on the outside edge, and I'm going to start creating some movement by just wiggling my brush in and out. We're going to go up underneath this turn place all the way to the tip. And then I'm just going to pat some of that in. Take my mop brush and mop, mop, mop. All right, let me show you that again. This is something you might want to practice on some paper if you feel like it's a little bit advanced for you. So I've got the paint on the toe. I'm going to push with the toe of the brush, okay, which is going to push it out, but it's also going to leave a little bit of water from this edge. So when I come back, I'll still be creating softness, okay? So I'm going to push. I need a little bit more paint there. Okay, pushing and kind of wiggling. Ran out of water, kind of wiggling as we go down all the way to the tip. And then I'm going to take and add some paint into that water and just tap it in there, and then just take my mop brush and gently tap that and kind of soften it out. Now, isn't that becoming just beautiful? Just beautiful. Do one of these other turned ones. Okay, we're going to do the outside edge. Wiggle. A little bit more paint. They're very... irises have... Well, some of them have smooth... petals. We got a little bit of a hard line right there, and I do not like that at all. So let me take that down. Try that again. I want softness here. Okay. A little bit better. Still not as I would like to see it, but I'm going to go with it. Alright, I'll make sure you're on camera here. Just a wiggling. We're going to go up underneath the wiggles on this turned edge all the way to the tip. Tap some in that water that we just left behind and gently mop it. Coming along beautifully. Alright, let's go to these other turned petals here. I'm going to do the same. Alright. can have soft pressure and not have a death grip on your brush, you will get a much better. Now I'm turning up on the toe here. Okay, I'm gonna put some in the water that we left back here. Some color. Now I'm just gonna gently mop that, soften it. Loaded my brush. Let's go to this side. Underneath the turn, all the way down to the tip. Come back here and tap in some purple and gently mop. Just wiggle the brush, wiggle, wiggle, wiggle. You're wiggling the toe. You don't have to worry about anything but the toe of the brush, the side that your paint is on. Tap some in, gently mop it. If you've got enough water on your brush, that will stay wet so that you can tap your paint back in there and gently soften it. There are different ways of floating, at least that I've found. Some people use more paint and less water. I tend to use quite a bit of both. Unless I'm wanting something really soft, then I've got a little bit more water than I have paint. Okay. Go down to my 6 curved flat here for a second. Brush off, and I want to do the turned edges. Darken them. Bring that up just a little bit. I don't want it to be so tight against that bottom edge. Okay, and this one. One more here. Okay. Okay, let's add a little bit of this dioxazine purple on the upper petals. We probably will just keep this, I might just keep this here on this main petal that's in the front. That up into that. I'm going to mop that. I'm going to mop the whole thing, but I'm still very, very gently mopping that. That is a super hard line right there. I mean, it's really dark right there, so I'm going to have to work that out, I think. But I've got to let it dry, because if I try while it's wet, it will just make it worse. Okay, more water. I need to get more, spritz more water on my palette. It's already dried up from my ceiling fan being on. So let's add some of this color back here on this petal. This is the dioxazine purple. And a little bit here around this turned part. We don't want these upper petals to be as dark as the lower ones. So I'm using this dioxazine purple a little sparingly up here. Okay, water. Now, when you're spritzing your palette, if you spritz the water in one place, your droplets will get bigger and bigger. But if you stay back a little bit and move the bottle around and spritz in random areas, you'll have more smaller drops of water. So sometimes you'll need bigger drops, and sometimes you will just need a few little ones. Alright, just a little bit. I don't want a whole lot of dark stuff going on here. Do a little bit up here because we're going to have some darker places. To reload here. So some of these places will be tucked back in here a little bit darker. So we can put some of that in there. Alright, this is looking good, but I want these petals down here to be so much more vibrant. So I've got some ultramarine blue on my palette, and I'm going to mix it with my dioxazine purple, equal amounts. And I'm going to apply this on the outer edges, like we just did a while ago. Walking it in towards the middle. It looks really, really bright on the camera, I know, but it is not that blue in front of me. This was equal amounts that I mixed here. I'm moving fairly quickly now because my fan is on. Need to get this on here before it dries. Tap, 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 clean your mop, dry your mop. Alrighty, more water. And I am just brush mixing, so my colors may not be exact on each petal, but that's okay. They do not have to be perfectly matched. I had to bring that side in a little bit more. Okay, mop, mop, mop. Loving that blue in there. Woo-hoo! Oh yeah. That's bringing back some good childhood memories. Those flowers that I used to pick. They were just growing wild behind our house. But as the years passed, they got less and less. And then pretty soon they weren't growing there anymore. Probably got choked out by weeds, I'm sure. Mop, 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 mop. Okay. Oh, those are looking so good. Okay, this one here, I want to bring the color out a little bit farther. It feels dry. Gently mop. I don't want to remove all that paint I just put on there. Alright, now I'm going to create a wash of this ultramarine blue. So I'm just going to dip into it and create a nice little glazy wash. It's a lot of water, not very much paint. Now I'm just going to lay my brush on the paper towel, let excess water get out, and I just want to wash this over this whole petal. It looks so blue on the camera screen, but I'm hoping when the video is up for viewing or records onto a disc that it doesn't look that bright, because although that is a beautiful color, I love that color. It looks very nice. Let's add some lines in this. We're going to use Snow White and our tin O liner. So now, one of the tips I want to give you is when you are thinning light colored paints, especially white or very pale yellow, anything that is a light color, you want to go into your clean water and get water. Because let me show you, it may not show as well because my water is not super dirty, but if you go into dirty water, like this is dirty water here, okay, this would be dirty water, and you pull that out, it's going to tint your paint. So you want to always go into clean water. So I had water on my brush, I dipped into my paint, I pulled it out, and now I'm blending the water with the paint. I want to get inky consistency so that my paint will flow nicely off of my brush. So then I go wash my brush out, I dry it off, the ferrule especially, and then I just pick up my paint, which I dip it in my paint, and then I roll the bristles to get a nice chisel point. Now, when you're using a liner brush, you want to stay up on the very tip. If your paint is like ink, it's going to flow right off of the tip of that brush. So we want to put some streaks coming in here. Some veiny stuff. I don't know what it is. Just whatever irises have. I'll put this in. I'm going to come back with some purple ones. Okay, this is going to be at the base of the petals. To do shape following so it looks more natural. Stay up on the very tip. My ceiling fan is drying my paint out faster than I can use it, so get a little bit more water. My room is so hot because it's partly over the garage, and then the attic is on the other wall. So it is a very warm room. And today is a warm day. Make some of these a little fatter. Not too fat. Oops. Alright, I want to take some of that dioxinine purple and the ultramarine blue and mix it together. We want it inky consistency as well. And we're going to create some veining in here. This color you can mix with dirty water because it doesn't matter. Some veins, some veiny stuff going on here. I'm going to try and make it a little bit nicer looking than what I just did. That was pretty sloppy. Even on this upturned part, not that thick. I'll have a few maybe coming up on it. Some of this down the center. Well, we left that opening. Just kind of streak it in. We don't want to cover that opening altogether. But we want to put some of that in there. I have all these tiny little veiny things going on. You feel like you've gotten it a dark line, just touch it back with your finger, and that will soften it. Some of our veining stuff going on in there. Alright, we're going to add a little bit lighter places on these petals, or I'm going to attempt it anyway. So I've got Purple Cow and Snow White. Actually, I think I might try Lavender. It might be the color I need instead of Purple Cow. Just brush mix Lavender and Snow White. I just dipped into each one and blended it on the end of my brush. Okay, now I probably should definitely go to a smaller brush here. Too much paint, so I wiped it off. I want that ruffly edge to be brighter. Move to my 6 curve flat, I think. Do these little ruffles. Might have 2 Snow White to 1 Lavender. Make it a little bit brighter. See, I'm turning the brush, having it straight up and down as opposed to flat when I get to these more narrow areas. Back over here and do this one. It's that same wavelength that we did on the outside edge there. Okay, we're going to have to go back and repeat that with some Snow White, I think. So, let's brighten this. This is just straight Snow White. Because the underneath edges of these petals are light. So, since they're flipped up, we're seeing the light part. Okay, now there's also going to be some of this lighter color showing up on the edges of some of our petals. So, let's say this one's flipped a little bit there. So we'll see that white edge there. So you can pick and choose where yours has some flips. So I'm just putting some paint in there, taking the water edge of this little brush and kind of smoothing that out. So just smooth it out with that water edge. Kind of blend it out. Give yourself that little look of it being turned a little bit there. We can put some on the tip here. Let's do some over here. Oops, throwing my brush around. And come back here on this. Paint way too far over on my brush here. So let me wipe it off, wash it off, and I'm going to reload it. I want to keep this a pretty tight float, so we want the paint to stay really tight on that toe. We want it to be bright. We'll probably come back and brighten that a little bit with another coat of white. So let's come over here and do some of these other ones. Just placing a little bit of white paint on there, and then just kind of taking the water edge, kind of soften it. Okay, two more here. Paint. Take that water edge, kind of soften that back. Okay, it's giving it a little bit more realistic look now. Flatten that out. Too far over on my brush again. So let me clean that out. Reload. That can happen very easily when you're using a small brush. Hope you were on camera for that. I apologize if you weren't. Paint too far over again. Okay. So now I want to go back and repeat that. And I'm not going to worry so much about pulling it out this time. I'm just going to go back and just touch some paint on there. Just a quick little touching of paint, even up here. On the tips where it will be the brightest. This is just a dibby dabbing here. Okay, that gives the leaf a little bit more of a rolled look. Alright, I want my purple to be darker, so let me get some more dioxazine purple out at the base. I want it to be darker at the base. Oh, let's take some dioxazine purple. I'm going to get some black green out. Ooh, I need to shake up. It's almost empty. Shake it up enough to use it. Oh, goodness. Alright, we don't need very much, so. Alright, so I'm going to take my brush and dip into my purple and a little bit of black green. Purple to look a little bit darker. I got a lot of water on my brush here. I still want it to look like purple, but I want it to be darker. Okay, that looks like a pretty dark purple. Probably could just go to a black plum. I want to put this color up here at the very back of the petal. Kind of walk it down a little bit. Very gently tap that. It out, very gently tap it. I don't want to remove it, I just want to gently blend that. Very gently. Okay, say that was probably about 2 dioxinine purples to 1 black green. Okay, I'm going to put some of this color underneath my turned places. Staying up on the tip because I'm using this larger curve flat. And I don't really want to change, but you probably could change to a 6 curve flat. Just a little line of this back here. I don't want a whole lot of that back on that turned edge. Now I want to take this color, and I think I'll go to my 6 curve flat, which is what I should have just been using there for those other places, but and I want to create some opposite of the where I put the white, so that gives more turned stuff going on, if that makes sense. It's going to give it a lot more movement. With this, we can kind of pull this out, make those petals look more active, I guess I should say. A little too dark right there. A little bit more here. I have to mix more often with this smaller brush. Excuse me. Oh, goodness. Put a little bit more here. Excuse me. Still give your brush that little wiggle to make movement. Just want to be drawing a painting on a straight, smooth line here. A little bit underneath. Some of these darker areas. This is kind of going to join those folded places together to make them look more natural. Okay, so now you can see how we've given that petal so much more movement just by adding those darker colors there. Now I need to darken at the base a little bit more. this down into the petal a little bit. Just bring it down a little. I'm sure you'd like to be on camera. Gently. Paint. Ooh, I was about to drop my brush right on that. That would not have been pretty. Those petals looking fabulous. They just look wonderful. I'm very pleased with how this is turning out, being that I've never painted an iris before. And couldn't 100% say I'm not 100% sure what I'm doing. So let me wide angle out so we can look at it, how it looks right now. Oh, that's looking good. Looking good. Love, love, love the colors. It's exactly what I was going for, was that deep, rich, vibrant purple. All right, we're going to get going on the upper petals now. All right, this is coming along nicely. Let's zoom in a little bit. We want to finish the center part of these outer petals here. Okay, so I've got a one round brush. I'm going to pick up some marigold on the tip of my brush, and I'm just going to tap this color in right here at the base. Bring it down just a little bit. Same here. Just tap, tap, tap. Kind of bring it down the center of that petal. I think I'll bring this one down a little bit more. Okay, let's do this one. To do this a couple of times with this color, kind of fades down in there a little bit. So let me get this dry. Okay, we've got our marigold on there. So now let's add a little bit of moon yellow, and we're going to bring this a little bit more down here. Just tap it in. I'm going to pick up a little bit of lavender and put a little bit of that in there. Not very much. I just dirty brushed into that so it wouldn't be quite so bright. Okay, I just wipe my brush off. Now I'm going to go into some snow white. Little tip-tap-dabbing thing. Okay, let's shade that back there at the back. So we're going to take our dioxygen purple and our black green mix. And just brush mix it right on your brush. Now we want to push that. We want to push that to the back. And you want to make sure that's dry before you paint over it, so that it doesn't look like it's way high. Okay, so just do that on all of them. Don't let it overtake all of your yellow. You just want to push that edge back a little bit. Now, if you want, this is completely optional, but on these flowers, they really kind of stick up, kind of pokey, I guess I should say. And we might get some cadmium yellow out. Maybe glaze over these a little bit. But you can make them a little more. Spiky. That's how they would naturally look on a flower. Kind of like little spiky things coming out. You can go into your purple and do a little bit that way. The dotting is just fine if you want to do it that way. I like to give it a little bit more if I can. A little bit more realism, I guess I should say. I'm just using my 10-0 liner. Pretty straight paint. Of course, my white paint was kind of thin coming out of the bottle, so if it's not flowing off of your brush very well, you'll want to add some water. Make it a little inky. I think for now that's going to finish the lower petals until I get the upper ones done and see if there's something else that I want to do here with this. So we're going to move up to the upper ones. And we want to start creating that movement like we did down here. So I have on my palette Snow White and our base color, which is lilac, and lavender. So let's start with I want to start with the Snow White. So we're going to load it on the toe of our 10 curved flat, just like we loaded all the other times. So it's just on the toe. And this is your water edge, so pick up water with that edge and blend it into your brush as you need it. Okay, let's start up here on this back petal here. And we want to start creating some like we did here, some high places. So we're going to wiggle this out. And I don't want to do the whole petal. The whole edge of the petal, I guess I should say. Because I want to come back and put some other color in there, like we did down here. Side. Alright, I'm going to go here. I'm going to have to do this side a couple times, I'm sure, because I did most of that side But I will come back and add some different color to set that back there a little bit. Give it more movement. I'm going to paint a little bit too far over on the brush here and wash it out. I think I might want to make that white wider. So I'm going to let it come over on my brush a little bit farther for this one. Laying my brush flat when I can. Give it that wiggly. Wiggly, wiggly motion there. I will try to have all of these wiggles, if I can, on the pattern. But if not, you just create your own little wiggles. You don't have to copy mine. Be your flower. All right, I probably should go to a smaller brush here. And you'd probably like to be on camera, wouldn't you? Okay. I'm going to go back up to this one up here. Because I want to make that white wider than when I have it. Now I'm just going to go down the whole edge because I just think that would be a little bit easier. Some of these flowers, when I went to look at some of them, the white part on the flower almost looked like you could see through it. It was such a fine, thin veil of color. All right, let's get a little bit more movement here. Just kind of working that over. Okay, that's looking really nice. Alright, oop, stuck my hand in. Let's repeat over here. I'm going to go from this way because it'll be easier for me. And then I can walk this out a little bit. Creating that soft because I've got the wet edge over here, so it's dampening, and I leave the paint, and I'm just walking it over and letting it be soft. I don't want to lose my kind of purple color under there. Okay, wide angle out a little bit. So you can see where this is going to. Oh, that's looking nice. Looking nice. Okay, let's zoom back in here. We want to create some veins in this like we did in this one. So we've got our lavender and our tin curve flat. So we're going to pull a vein, a very soft vein. Probably could have done this before we did the white. But let's see, that's not even the center, so let me wipe that off. Try that again. This is kind of the center here. I want these veins to be a little bit more on the very soft side. We'll see a little bit of vein in this one. This is lavender. I don't have very much paint on my brush. I've got plenty of water. Let me show you. I've got plenty of water on my brush. Dip into my lavender here. See, there's hardly any paint on my brush, just a very little sheer color of it. Might be able to see a little bit in this one back here. Okay. Now we're going to go to our tin O-liner. I'm going to thin down our lavender. We want it pretty thin, kind of sheer like that. That we just put in there, so it's really very sheer color. Okay, so I'm going to lay my brush and my paper towel and get the excess water out. So now we want to create some veining in these. I'm going to come up the flower. These flowers have so many little veiny things going on in them. You just want to make sure that we keep this very soft. It's kind of like making tree branches. Just, you know, make a line and make some more come off of it. This will wrap around on this, so we'll have some coming off of that. Go ahead and put a line down the center. This is still just that lavender. And these are the finest lines. So do not make them heavy or fat, or it'll take away from the realness of your flower. Your paint needs to be super watery, and you need to be up on the very tippy toe of this brush. So we've got some super fine little lines on there. All right, let's go back into our lavender. And we are going to load for floating. And we want to just darken at the base and up the middle. With some sheer floating here. Not quite as sheer as we did our lines, but it's still a pretty sheer color because we want these petals to stay very, very light up here. You're just going around redefining those bright white edges, making sure that they retain their nice edges. You can put some of this color in where it would be like the darkest shadow areas. Stay off of your white. I have to go back and redo the white on that edge right there. Alright, let's come down and do this one. I'm going to have to move my stem over a little bit here, it looks like. I'll put a little bit of this color up the center. Our white edges stay looking crisp there. Alright, I'm not sure if I want to add any dioxin purple on that one or not. I think real quick I'm going to fix this stem. So let me get some avocado out. So I can move the base of that over a little bit. Some more lavender up in here. Alright. Okay, I want to use some Dioxinine Purple, but I'm going to use it sparingly because I don't want these top ones to become dark. And I might use some green on these. So I want to put a little bit, just a little bit down here, like where it's coming out of the stem. Now I'm going to get a little bit of avocado and just brush and mix it right on my brush here. Need some more water in my brush. It's not wanting to, paint's not wanting to come off. I want to put a little bit of this green down here, just on that leaf. Okay, I think our flowers are looking wonderful. I think I'm going to add a little bit more white on the outer edges, though. I just want to make sure that the outer edges of these pop. I'm not giving a lot of pressure because I don't want tons of paint to come off of my brush. Kind of staying up on the toe. I just want it to be a little bit crisper. Especially on the very tips of those petals. I want those petals to really say, look at me. Okay, we've just got the stems and the leaves to finish now. I think those flowers are looking pretty done. Okay, I see a little bit of shading I need to do underneath this petal. Just around it. I'm just using lavender because I don't want it to be too dark. I think it's looking pretty darn good. Okay, I'm going to take my Dioxinine Purple, just because I feel like this still needs a little bit of depth right there. it's looking pretty good. All right, before we move on to finish up the stems, I think I might add, I don't know if I'm going to like this or not. Let me try it on one up here. I'm thinking about adding some purple on the edge. Nope. I think I just want to keep them white. Just white. I don't need all that. I wanted to keep them more the purpley white. Okay. So I'm going to take my my media paint. And it is dioxazine purple. And it is very pigmented. And I'm going to create a little wash. Now look how rich this color is of this paint. It is just beautiful. I want to wash this over these outer petals. Now this is optional. You do not have to do this part. Just mopping that. I'm very pleased with how this is looking. Okay, I want to put a little bit of this up in here on this flower. Just a little bit. Really mop that back. And the center of this one, just a little bit. And then maybe here and there, put a little bit of this. Maybe this one here along the center. I don't have very much paint on my brush at all. Okay, I think that's going to finish things up very, very nicely. Very nicely. All right, we're going to move on to our stems now. And the stems for, or the leaves for these are very simple. They don't have a center vein. They don't have a lot of, there's not a lot of detail to these leaves. They're just a thick leaf. So we're going to shade with some black green, and everywhere that one leaf lays on top of another leaf, we are going to shade with our black green back here. I've moved up to a 12 curved flat, but you can stay with your 10 curved flat. These leaves are pretty vibrant green, so we won't be making them any darker than what they are, except with our shading. I think this has been a pretty fast little project. When I first thought about painting an iris, which I thought about painting one for quite some time, I just kept looking at the picture of the iris that I have, thinking, oh my goodness, how am I going to get all those ruffles in there? That just looks so difficult. Much, much easier. Let me spray some water on my palette here. Than I expected it to be, so I'm hoping you that are painting it along with me as well found it much easier to do. black green wherever something lays over a leaf. All were you. Fun project. Just a few more steps here. Those leaves are looking fabulous. Such a fun project. Of course, I have fun pretty much with everything that I paint, so I cannot complain that any of this is not fun. I just hope it's fun for you, because painting should be fun, should be stress-free. Gone down to a little bit smaller brush here. So I've got some smaller areas in here I want to get to. Up on the toe right there. I'm flipping this all around, so I'm hoping I'm keeping you on camera there. Let's put some black green down the edges of this. Just gonna streak some in there. I'm up on the very tippy-toe of this. I should probably go to a 6 curved flat, but I would recommend that you go to a 6 curved flat. I've got a 10 here. Okay, one more side here. Back and any place that you feel like needs to be a little bit darker, just go back and make that a little bit darker. some of this down here at the base. These. I think that needs to be a little darker. These are looking fabulous. Looking good. Okay. I'm going to erase my graphite line here. My separation lines that I put on here. Okay, let's highlight with some olive green. Okay, olive green, we're going to put it a little bit too much on my brush there. Lighten up these leaves a little bit. Oh, I've got my 10 curved flat again. Nope, 12. So I should probably go down to my 10. And I'm sure you'd love to be on camera, wouldn't you? Let's try that again. Okay, I'm just kind of putting this on all the avocado parts that are left. Smooth it out with your finger or use your mop brush, either one. Try to keep it off of your shadow part. When you first put it on, this olive green is going to look bright as can be. But it fades down in there and becomes a very nice, soft color. A wonderful, wonderful complement for these leaves. Again, you're not on camera. Good gracious, let me wide out, angle out a little, just a little bit. So as I spin it, hopefully you will not get off of camera and be yelling at me, I am so sorry. I didn't mean it, I didn't mean it. Please forgive me. You know, I am just kind of tapping in some color here. I try not to give my brush a whole lot of pressure unless I'm base coating, because I just want to leave behind a little bit of paint. I don't want to leave tons and tons, and I use the water edge as much as possible to smooth it out and soften it, like right there. I just use the water edge and smooth that out. Definitely need more water in my brush. It is dry as a bone. Let's put some of this down the center. Go to a smaller brush. Don't be like me and be hard-headed and stick with that super big fat brush that is probably just going to make it worse. Okay, so we've got our first highlight on there. Oh, this is looking so good, so good. Let's repeat a little bit of highlight on here. And we don't have to do every single place. But we want to create some little bit brighter places. Maybe the tips would be a good choice for making a little bit brighter. My dog is panting like crazy. Sure, what she needs. All right, you can just pick and choose a few places to brighten up. A second little quick highlight there. I want to take some of the lavender, maybe. I have to get some fresh out. I want to put a little bit of purple in my leaves. So I'm just going to dirty brush right into that purple, that lavender. And maybe put some streaks of this on my leaves in a few places. Maybe the dioxinine purple would be better. Let me try that. Ooh, too much. Too much, baby! Let me smooth that out of there. Oh yeah, I like that. I like that. So we can put this in some random places. Put some up here on our stem area. So instead of lavender, let's use the dioxinine purple. I think it looks much nicer. Just help carry that color around a little bit. Some water. Get it flowing. I've got paint all over my highlight right there. See if I can get it off. Oh, now I'm spreading paint everywhere. Do not do what I'm doing. Go to a smaller brush. For our purple. Oops. Way out of line there. Okay. I think that looks nice. One last thing. That will be to take our liner brush and let me get some avocado out. And flip it around. Thin my avocado down to inky consistency. And let's pull a few blades of grass up on this. water here. It's not. There we go. That's what we want. Some nice flowing off of the brush here. Let's take some olive green and thin it down and add a few blades of that. Be to take some avocado on the toe of our curved flat or a flat brush, it doesn't matter. And now we just want to set all this, give it some foundation here. A little grassy area. Set our piece in. So let us zoom out. Well, before I zoom out, I'm going to sign this. I have a terrible habit here lately of not signing my pieces, so let me sign this. Goodness, it's been so long since I've signed anything, I've forgotten how to write with a paintbrush. Can't get my paint thin enough. Okay, there we have it. Okay, I'm going back in and making a couple adjustments here. So let me zoom you in here. I felt like after I stepped away from this and came back to it, that the folds up here on these petals needed to be a little bit more defined, kind of like the folds are down here. So I'm going in. Adding a little bit of shading in those V areas. A little bit of lavender. You could mix a little bit of the lilac in as well. Make them look a little more bit more movement to them. So it's just like making a little V kind of in it and pulling it out. I don't have very much paint on my brush. And I've got water on the water edge so I can soften where I'm putting this. Kind of every place that has a where when you took it out, then you came back in with the white. So all these little places where it like came back in. Creating some folds there. Some more defined folds, I think. I think that makes it look a little more realistic. I've kind of covered up my lines, my vein lines on here, so I might have to go back and put those back in with my liner. So at the end, those are some of the things you can do at the end, is go in and look and see what might need to be defined a little bit more. Just kind of pulling those little folded areas just kind of down into the petal itself. This on all of the upper petals. Don't have very much paint now on my brush. I mean, you can't even see it on my brush. I've got so little on there. We don't want it to take away from the white that we put on here. More paint on my brush here. This is definitely giving it a lot more depth. Okay, that definitely gives the flower a lot more movement than it had. So I am liking that. More water. Can't make my paint move if I don't have water on my brush. So now if you feel like you need to, you can always go back in and add some more white on here. So, there's a couple places I want to add a little bit of white. Just adding a touch of white here and there. Zoom out here and see how this is looking. I think I'm going to add my veins back in this one. You can't see them hardly at all. Just needs to have that little bit of detail in it. Makes it look more realistic. This is the dioxazine purple. I really should go to a smaller brush. I just want some in the dark crevices. Let me zoom out here. Definitely liking the folds much better. Alright, so this is kind of just where you can go back and just tweak. See everything that you, just look at every little place individually can just determine where you think a little bit more needs to be. And then just add that little bit in there. Much better, much better. Okay, now I think we're done. All right, so we've got it done. Let's put it together. Looks nice. I think it turned out wonderful. All right, thanks for painting with me.